Welcome to New Perspectives on RVN Television. I'm your host, Barry Lefkowitz. What does it take to be able to write a definitive biography and have access to credible individuals to be interviewed? Bob Crane, the definitive biography, was written by three women who were dedicated and devoted to write the story of Bob Crane, a multi-talented musician, disc jockey, television star, theater, and movie actor. However, upon his murder in June 29, 1978, a different side of Bob Crane, known for his highly successful TV series, Hogan's Heroes, still being shown on television today, a darker side was blared by the media that pushed all of his success to the back, and a seedy character was portrayed by every form of media. The three authors want to give you a true insight to this well-known celebrity of the 60s through 1978, when he was mysteriously murdered in Scottsdale, Arizona, in his hotel room while he was the lead actor in a play called Beginner's Luck. Providing us with the insights to the real Bob Crane and what it took to author their book is my guest today, Carol Ford and Linda Greenwalder, who is actually coming from Australia. The third writer, Dee Young, was unfortunately unable to join us. Ladies, thank you for joining us, and especially Linda, because I know it's the middle of the night in Australia. But
it is.
You know, Linda, starting with Linda, could you share with us, the audience, your background?
Sure. Thank you so much for having us along today. We're always happy to talk about Bob. I am a former news reporter and news anchor, having spent several years in New England radio in both New Hampshire and Massachusetts. I have an honors degree in communications and English from Riviere College, which is now Riviere University in Nashua, New Hampshire. I grew up in Massachusetts, but I moved to Australia in 1994 with my Australian husband. And aside from my work in the banking industry, which is now how I just earn a crust, I am active in the theater, both on stage and as a director and producer. So I'm a busy, busy woman.
It sounds like it. Carol, you're actually located here in the States. Can you share with us your background?
Sure. Thank you, Barry. And thank you for having us on today. Linda and I really appreciate it. I am an author, an editor, an artist, and a podcaster. I earned my honors degree in English liberal arts from Glassboro State College, which is now Rowan University in Glassboro, New Jersey. My current position is senior director of editorial services at Anthony J. Jannetty Incorporated, where I have been employed for nearly 25 years now. At Jannetty, I am a managing editor of professional peer-reviewed nursing journals and scholarly textbooks. I also own my own production company, and so I don't sleep very much.
I understand, but clearly the two of you have significant professional backgrounds and are quite accomplished ladies. And that's one of the things, by the way, we like to do on our show is to have women as role models, because we need to be able to recognize the contributions of women. I'm curious, why did the two of you become interested in Bob Crane? Why don't we start this time with Carol and then Linda?
Sure. I grew up watching Hogan's Heroes. This was back in the 1980s, primarily when it ran in syndication on PHL 17 right here in Philadelphia. And I just became, I just adored Bob Crane as a kid. I loved Hogan's Heroes. So when I was about 15 years old, which was about 1985 or so, I learned Bob had been murdered and that his murder had been unsolved, was unsolved. And that just really hit me really hard as a 15-year-old kid. So I became very determined way back then to learn who Bob was and find out really what made him tick. Now, that was when I was 15 years old. It was also a time when we didn't have internet. So I did what you could call preliminary research without knowing that's what it was. I'd run to the Camden County Library. I'd sit in the microfilm and microfiche room there and just search for hours looking for articles about Bob and his murder. But it was all kind of tied together at that time. It was devastating to me as a kid that he had been murdered, and I wanted to know more. So then fast forward a couple of decades later to about 2005 or so, and Linda and I connected on this fancy thing we now call the internet, which we didn't have back then. Linda informed me she was researching Bob for a biography, and I said, say no more. And we joined forces along with Dee Young. And then once we discovered Bob's true story and connected with so many people from his life, Linda, Dee, and I we've just never stopped researching or trying to set the record straight for Bob. He deserves so much better than what he got since his death. You know, he murdered, misunderstood, ridiculed, and then eventually his legacy that he had worked so hard on during his life has been all but destroyed. He's not here to tell his story, so we humbly do it for him.
No, much appreciated. Mm-hmm. Linda, what precipitated your deciding to start, you know, researching for doing a biography? And it was
I think I just got a touch on the shoulder one day, really. I grew up watching Hogan's Heroes in my household. It was, my dad loved it in the early 70s. I have a few years on Carol, so we saw it in the first couple of runs of syndication. So I have long been familiar with the characters. I hadn't seen the show for a very, very long time. And sometime in 2003, I came across Hogan's Heroes on cable television. And it was like meeting old friends. It was amazing. I still knew all the characters. I knew the theme song. I just didn't remember anything about the plots of the show specifically. So I remembered that something had happened. And so I went on the internet when I got home and just to see what I could find out about the actors. And I found a lot that I didn't know. And of course I knew Bob had been murdered, and I remembered that I was about 11 years old when he was killed, and my parents didn't want me to read the newspaper. And I said, well, now let me see what I didn't know. And being an actor myself, a former radio person, and New England born and bred, all of which I have in common with Bob, I was fascinated, but I was so offended that so much that would make Bob into a three-dimensional person was buried by scandal and sex and murder and scandal and sex and murder. So something in me just said, that's not fair. I better do something about that. And so my old journalistic instincts just floated to the surface, and I got started right away.
Now, there were three of you involved in terms of, you know, the definitive biography, including Dee Young. How did you divvy up the different roles that you played in order to be able to work together on this project?
I don't believe just one person could have done this. We didn't necessarily divvy up the roles. It was things that we fell into because of our particular strengths. And because we each have different strengths, we brought those to the project. So, I mean, yes, in theory, somebody could have just, one person could have done this, but I don't think it would have turned out into what it has become. We didn't just write a book. We've taken on a responsibility of keeping the correct information going to balance out all of the erroneous stuff that's out there. Dee and Linda and I, we're pretty powerful. We're a powerful force to be reckoned with. We had a very large mountain to climb. It was not going to be easy. Reverend Ed Beck was the person who was counseling Bob shortly before his death, and he was one of the first people to agree to talk with us about Bob. And that's really important because he was the one who really showed us that underneath all of the news headlines, the tabloid headlines and so forth, that Bob had good in him. Because remember, we didn't know what we were going to learn. And so as Reverend Beck told us when he first responded to our request, the mountain you seek to climb, though admirable, is formidable. I applaud you for your quest, but the media does not want to hear what you have to say. And that was one of the first things that we got back from somebody who was very much connected to Bob in a very important way. And so, like I said earlier, divvying up the roles, it was more of a natural place where we all fell into what our strengths were and what made this entire project and the research, the book, all of it as powerful as it has become.
Carol's absolutely right. The one person could not have done this book in any way that would have it come out before we were in our 70s. You know, we all have different strengths. Dee had all the contacts or a lot of contacts in Connecticut. I have interviewing, organizational editing skills. Carol has a knowledge of the publishing industry and the dedication to take on this Herculean task of actually putting pen to paper, plus joining forces the way we did. And as difficult as it was beginning this project being, you know, 10,000 miles away, meant that we could actually work on this pretty well around the clock, since we're on opposite ends of the world. And, you know, I'm 14 hours ahead of Carol, sometimes 15 hours ahead. That means as she's heading to bed, my day was just beginning and vice versa. And so we were able to work on this almost constantly one way or another. And if somebody contacted me and it was late in the day and I said, gosh, I don't know, you know, I don't know what something that I need to say to this person, or I need some information to connect with this person, I could go to bed and hand that to Carol and she would pick it up and she could do the same with me.
That sounds like quite a collaboration of working together. I guess I know part of when you talked about Connecticut has to do with Bob's roots, you know, with his radio program. But I guess, you know, it would be helpful for us both in terms of about Bob Crane, but also in terms of what it takes to be a writer. How difficult was it to write the biography? And, you know, you were joking saying that you'd be 70 if you did it on your own. But how long did it take, you know, the three of you working together?
Well, it took well over a decade to actually research. I think somewhere around 12, 13 years to do the full research process, not counting, you know, all the preliminary stuff I did way back when or you know, whatever. It really took well over a decade. It took 2 years to write. That's a long time to write a book. It's also a very big book because there was a lot to cover. Now, what helped me with writing that,
Carol,
was that in 2011,
Carol,
during the research phase,
Carol,
I nominated Bob for the National Radio Hall of Fame at their request. And so in order to do it properly, I ended up sending a lengthy document of about 100 pages, mostly of its radio work, but also some biographical things in there as well. So this served as an overall outline and a starting point. Writing is very easy for me. I'm used to doing evidence-based editing because of the scholarly publications that I work on at work, and I write very quickly, but this book was challenging because there are so many facets to Bob Crane. So the most difficult part of that was writing the organization of it. Bob was extremely talented. He had many things going on at once. During the 1970s in particular, everything was going on. He had radio, television, theater, drumming, motion pictures. And then you had family, his first marriage ending, his second marriage getting married, and then marital troubles in his second marriage in 1978, and then plus the addiction. So there was the organization of this was the most challenging part. How do you organize it and tell the story without having the addiction casting a shadow on everything?
We're going to have to stop there for a moment because we have to do that thing known as a commercial break. But please stick with us because the insights that Carol and Linda will be able to provide on Bob Crane, the radio personality, the musician, the actor, and at the same time address part of about his murder and the fact that he was actually trying to deal with his sex addiction. So please stick with us. We'll be right back.
Aloha. Joe Silva here with Kukua Technologies. I'm excited to see you on Tuesdays on Morning Coffee for our tech tips.
Let's face it, lawyers get a bad rap. I'm Erin Bruschi, host of Legal Breakdown, where we dissect legal topics for the everyday viewer, with a mix of interesting guests to talk about current events and hot legal topics. Let's work together to make the law accessible and relevant to everyone. Catch us every week on RVN Television.
Welcome back to New Perspectives on RVN Television. I'm your host, Barry Lefkowitz. We are interviewing two extremely accomplished women who are phenomenal writers and have a tremendous professional background. When we went to the break, Carol, you were telling us about how difficult it was to write the biography and the amount of time in terms of the research of a decade or so, and then 2 years to write the book itself. But I know, Linda, during the break, you said that you wanted to provide some further insight. So could you pick up from there, please?
Sure. It's really just a small point, and that is that even during the writing of the book, research continued. There were sections that we thought we had down, and another source came through, and we had to adapt and change and add, you know, everything based on as much information as we can get. So all of that continued during the writing process. I remember distinctly during one of a part of the editing process that one person brought through a piece of information that we said, this is too important to leave out. We need to go back. So we went back and we did more research and we asked more questions. Also, it was really important for the addiction of Bob's life to be kept separate from the rest of his life. From to understand him as a full person is to be able to see everything. Now, we're not psychologists or experts in sexual addiction, or in any kind of addiction for that matter. So we've been talking with the Reverend Ed Beck, but to understand more, we actually reached out to four experts in sexual addiction. We cannot put Bob on a couch to psychoanalyze him. He's not here, but we can try and get a little more information to have an understanding of what was going on around him and what effects addiction had on him and on his life. So we continued during the whole process down to the very last minute to try and understand all of Bob as an individual and then also as a person with an addiction.
That brings to mind then, you know, the fact that you constantly had these sources, but what kind of access did you have to the family and then to various key sources that you used for putting together your book? I guess we'll go start with Linda this time and then Carol.
Well, one of our very first contacts actually came indirectly through Dee, because the first thing I did was contact WICC in Connecticut, which was a radio station in which Bob was very successful before he moved to Los Angeles. And Dee got me in touch with someone who got me in touch with Bob's first cousin from Waterbury, Jim Senich. He was so kind and he was so funny. And he had lots to say. He was very, very close to Bob and he was very supportive of the project. One thing he said to me really stuck in my head, and that was that he said, Bobby was a big teddy bear. He was a very soft fella. And a lot of people think he walked around with horns sticking out of his head, but it just wasn't true. Bob was loved. You know, in addition, Bob's youngest son, Robert Scott, was quite open with us and has been interviewed by us several times. And the thing is, once someone spoke with us, they were in. It was like we had a 200-person cheerleading squad just encouraging us and pushing us along and cheering for us, because they all wanted the true story told. And it just snowballed to the point where occasionally we'd get someone saying, here, you need to speak to this person. So we got access originally through a bit of luck and hard work. And then after that, it just flew.
Carol? Yes, absolutely. Just like Linda said. So, you know, it snowballed, it flew. The thing is that when they heard what we were doing and what that we were going to do right by Bob, they became part of the process. And that was so interesting but humbling, because now we didn't expect that part of it. It also took a long time to earn their trust, because remember, what do they have prior to this? They have a film that was released in the theaters, which we're going to get to, I think, yes. Barry. Mm-hmm. And they've had tabloid headlines. They've had just a lot of negativity. And when they were called to talk about Bob, they didn't want to talk about just Bob the actor or Bob the coworker. It was, let's talk about the sex. The cast of Hogan's Heroes actually made a pact to, if they called to talk about Bob, that they were going to say good things about Bob, because there was so much negative in the press during those years following the murder. And nobody called. Nobody wanted to hear the good things. So it took a long time to earn their trust. They had been burned, or they were distraught by all this negativity. And then when they realized where we were coming from, they wanted to be a part. They were in on it. And as Linda said, they were our cheerleaders. And we heard so many times, we're in this with you. In addition to that, I also had access to all of Bob's belongings, exclusive access to all of Bob's belongings through his son, Scott. I spent 3 days in his storage facility just going through Bob's belongings, everything, you know, you name it. What do we have in our storage facilities? You know, we have our notebooks and our diaries and our photographs and our, you know, everything that meant something to Bob was in there. And Bob kept everything. Mm-hmm. What really touched me during that is that Scott and his mother, Patricia Olson, who was Bob's second wife, played Hilda on Hogan's Heroes. They kept everything exactly the way it was since the day Bob died. So for instance, his wallet still has everything in it. His money, his driver's license, a book of postage stamps, all of it unchanged. Money never spent, exactly as it was on June 29th, 1978. And we also have to make sure we mention Bob's school friends, his Connecticut radio colleagues. All of these people became such a huge part of this process. Some of them, unfortunately, didn't live long enough to see it being published. And so if you look in the front of the book, it's dedicated to a man named Charlie Zito, who passed away in 2010. He was Bob's best friend from school. All of Bob's school friends, the people that we talked with, they were so supportive of all of what we were doing or trying to do to tell Bob's true story.
How many people in total did you actually end up interviewing for your book? And, you know, obviously they provided you with access when practically everybody else was denied access.
Mm. We talked to more than 200 people.
That was that reference to the 200 cheerleaders.
What we'd call prominent people, I suppose.
Yes.
From all walks of his life, from his family, from his childhood, from school, from work, from the charity events that he did, from his music, from radio to television. You know, as Carol said earlier, it was really a matter of earning their trust. You know, you had to, one or two people took a leap of faith, and the more those people did that, the easier it was for other people to come aboard. And I think there was really just such a great desire on the part of people to have a true story told. They constantly told us, so many people told us how relieved they were that someone wanted to tell the story of the Bob that they knew. And they were trusting us with that. And each person helped, you know, the next person to come, because we would send out a request and we'd say, these people have been involved, and the list got longer. And those people might recognize some names on the list and say, I trust that person's integrity. If they think it's okay, it's okay. So it was really humbling, really very, very humbling, and quite a privilege to have so many people involved telling us things that they had held dear for, you know, 20 years, 30 years. We continue our work today by our podcasts and interviews and whatnot, in part to honor their participation and keep their stories out there, because they were kept silent for so long.
Well, we actually ran out of time, but for the audience, so you're aware, we're doing a two-parter. So next week, you will actually see Carol and Linda get deeply into about the movie Autofocus, which was a harsh portrayal of Bob Crane. And then they're going to share with you all of the magnificent insights of Bob Crane, from the musician, the radio personality, to movie star, television star, etc. So I will see you next week. And as always, I thank you for allowing me into your homes each and every week. Please stay safe, stay well, and don't forget, next week you're going to see part two of Bob Crane, the definitive biography. Take care.